At this time, we have an addition to the agenda. Is there a motion to approve that addition?
Mayor Veneer, I move that we add 7.4 to the agenda.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to add item 7.4 to the agenda. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. Now it's time for the citizens' forum, a time for citizens to come before the commission to speak on anything that is not on the official agenda. Is there anyone here from the public that would like to speak? If not, we'll move on. We have no awards or proclamations. Public hearings and items scheduled for a certain time.
Item 5.1, public hearing on the 2008 budget amendments.
Mr. Franz.
Mayor and commissioners, many times during December, we do some minor budget modifications to bring our planned expenditures in line with either money received and passed through or to make other minor corrections. This year there are several of those. First is in the general fund, dealing primarily with the way the cable television franchise is treated. In prior years, when we had the franchise directly with the cable provider, the franchise provided for a pass-through arrangement to public and education government access, or PEG access is what we would call it. At the time that the franchise was taken over by the state of Kansas, that pass-through requirement, of course, which was specific to Salina, disappeared. As a result, we must now budget for that pass-through as both an expense and a revenue in the general fund, and this budget amendment accomplishes that. Tourism and Convention Fund, we have a minor budget amendment to account for additional receipts through the year. The original budget was for $1 million. We've actually received $1,066,554. And in order to distribute the full amount of those receipts, as is provided for in our agreement with the Chamber of Commerce, we must amend the budget to provide for those distributions. We'll increase the amount that goes to the Chamber of Commerce from $600,000 to $639,932. And we'll increase the transfer to the Bicentennial Center from $400,000 to $426,622. Bicentennial Center Fund, we're adjusting to accommodate the change in carryover from the prior year, the additional guest tax revenue, which I just referred to, and additional service charges. Expenses are also modified to reflect mid-year estimate charge changes in services, supplies, and capital. The budget for the Bicenter will increase from $1,711,554 to $1,722,615, a relatively small amount. Central Garage budget is being amended to accommodate largely changes in fuel costs for the year, as well as some modest adjustments to personal and contractual services line items. Revenues have also been adjusted to account for the increased charges to other funds for the services provided. The Central Garage budget will increase as a result of this from $1,609,361 to $1,873,529. And finally, the Business Improvement District. We're modifying the budget to be able to distribute the full amount collected, and that this will provide about $4,500 more to the Salina Downtown Incorporated. Be glad to try to answer any questions that you might have.
Questions of staff. If not, I will now open this up to a public, open up the public hearing. Is there any comment from the public? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. I don't have a gavel, so I have to use my knuckles. And bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I'd move we approve the proposed amendment to the 2008 budget.
Second. We're moving and seconded to approve the budget amendments. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. Consent agenda.
Item 6.1, approve the minutes of December 15, 2008. Item 6.2, resolution number 08-6583, describing the corporate limits of the City of Salina. Item 6.3, authorized purchase of a VOC analyzer from Inficon Incorporated in the amount of $45,901. Item 6.4, authorized purchase of a trailer-mounted power vacuum excavator from Ditch Witch of Kansas in the amount of $33,111.83. Item 6.5, approve the 2009 Special Parks Fund Capital Improvement Program. Item 6.6, resolution number 08-6584, amending the City of Salina Personnel Manual.
Are there any items a commissioner would like pulled from the agenda?
And a question on 6.3.
And I would like to have item 6.6 pulled from the consent agenda. We need a motion to do that.
No, okay. Don't believe so, Mayor.
Thank you. Question?
I'm not sure who to direct this to. I'm just curious. Says on this blue sheet here that bids are received on December 16th, 2008 as follows. And this company out of Loveland, Colorado, it says no bid. Well, why'd they send it, take trouble to send a letter? What, if they didn't send a bid, what?
I don't know if Martha has additional details, but sometimes they will formally submit a no bid just to acknowledge that they were aware of the bid.
That would be correct. As Mike stated, we purchase a lot of laboratory equipment from Hawk Company, so they wanted to acknowledge that they got the information, but they were not able to bid this specialized piece of equipment. So
okay.
We do, on several occasions, get items that will mark back no bid just because they want to stay on our list and go
okay.
forward.
If there are no other questions on the consent agenda, do I hear a motion to approve the consent agenda 6.1 through 6.5?
I will make that motion.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda, which is 6.1 through 6.5. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. On item 6.6, my questions concern Article Sections 2 and 3 of Article 15 on vacation. And how that changes from what the policy is presently. Either Ms. Fisher or Mike.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Commissioners. The question in regards to the potential changes in the vacation policy, we currently do not have a cap. So the language that is before you is implementing a cap at 250 hours and 350 hours respectively for our regular 40-hour per week employees and the 24-hour shift employees. And then language in Section 2, D and E, E specifically grandfathering a system to where the vacation hours aren't technically taken away from the employees that exceed the cap currently, but a method to freeze the hours and to work on not letting any hours accrued in the future go above those caps. If that makes sense.
It does, to some extent. I guess my question is vacation, in my view, is not to be used as a retirement account. And that appears as that's gone on for a number of years. And while we've looked at budgets where there is an incredible amount of money that has to be paid to buy out vacation time, we've already paid for that vacation once, and now we have to do it again. I'm struggling with, I think we're just perpetuating the problem, although we are slowing the bleeding down, or maybe even, I don't think we're stopping the bleeding, but we're slowing it down. Can you give me some rationale on how the 250 hours, how that was picked, or what?
Yes. Discussions with employee council on any changes that were proposed in line with the budget that this summer. Those meetings began, and as a result of trying to come up with what other municipalities are doing and what number they used, we sent out a brief survey. From that survey, we received approximately 19 responses, and we looked at the caps that people have into place. Most entities did have a cap. There were a couple that did not. But we looked at what the low was, what the high was. We didn't choose the low or the high. We chose a number. Jason Gage and I looked at the numbers, and Jason set it at slightly above average. And that was where the 250. Where the 350 hours comes in is that is 40% higher because of the ratio of the fire department when they take the vacation. It's 24 hours at a time. Their accruals are also 40%, so it was just a matter of ratioing up.
And if I read this correctly, somebody could have a substantial amount of vacation time built up over the years, and that number is grandfathered in there.
Correct. It is a current benefit that they own. Given the provisions, the personnel manual, that benefit is theirs.
And then each year they would either be required to take 80 hours of vacation or be paid for 80 hours of vacation. Is that correct?
They would be required to either use a buyback method that's currently in place, but even the maximum buyback would not cover the, if they have been here long enough to where they're accruing the maximum amount of accruals, they would still either be forced to take some vacation or to lose some hours at the beginning of the next year. So it's a hybrid of, we still may be buying some hours back, but they either have to take some vacation or there would be a loss situation for them. But they would not have a reduction on their current hours that are banked.
Do any other commissioners have questions about this?
What percentage of the employees do we have that falls into this category?
Okay, let's see here.
Just approximately.
And this encompasses both tiers, the 250 hours and the 350 mm-hmm. hours. A little over 17% of the employees are at or above the cap, so it would impact them.
Okay. And they're aware?
Yes, we've had several discussions.
Okay.
I would hope they're aware. We've had several discussions with our employee council and executive staff, and hopefully they've had this explained to them pretty thoroughly.
Okay.
Mayor, if I may, I'll try to summarize a couple of points. With respect to the pension padding, for organizations that don't have a cap, that's kind of a common strategy of employees, or it's not uncommon for employees to recognize that and accrue balances. And so this was done deliberately to try to take that into account, and as Natalie said, not only as part of their personnel policy, but just as part of the legal issues related to their accrued vacation, that is something that they own that we couldn't necessarily take away from them. We have some ability to regulate how it's used. With respect to accruing, by implementing it as proposed, that establishes their current level as the cap, so they either would have to use everything they accrue on an annual basis, either through use or buyback, or they would lose that. It would be a use or lose going forward above their cap. But it was intentional on the part of city staff's part when this was drafted to try to take into account that value that the employees have accrued in transition from no cap to kind of stopping the bleeding with the existing caps, and then going forward, no one would be able to accrue above and beyond that.
But if grandfather level stays the same and there are pay increases along the way, that is really compensating them more than what was originally planned, correct?
That's true. That is certainly part of the downfall or the cost associated with having no caps on your vacation accrual to begin with. So that in that instance, if you use it later in your career, it's at a higher rate, and if you use it near the end of your career, well, actually in the CAPR system, if you use it to create your highest to average salary, it could impact your pension benefits.
I don't believe that was the original purpose of vacation, was it?
I don't know that it was, but I'm confident that some employees have intentionally accrued their balances with that in mind. And so this policy was, trying to take that into account, but also take into account the legalities of it being something that they own and our ability to regulate that.
Is the buyback provision in this the same as the current buyback provision, that you can still buy back 10 to 100? You can require the city to buy back 8 to 100 hours?
We did.
At any time?
We proposed a slight increase, if I understood the question correctly. It's currently at 80 and 112 hours that the maximum buyback over the course of the year, that was the proposed increase, recognizing that some departments do have a difficult time having some of their individuals take the vacation. One other thing that I'd like to note is, in the event that, say, a cap of 500 is grandfathered for an individual, if through usage and buybacks their hours are 450 at the beginning of next year, they still don't have the 500 cap. They have a new cap. So whatever numbers fall below their current grandfathered cap is proposed. Mm-hmm. As their balance drops, you know, at the beginning of the year next year, it won't exceed that. It would be 450.
Do you really think that'll happen?
It might.
If you're getting a raise every year and you're going to be paid on that new rate, do you really think that'll happen?
We had several questions about it from employees. What happens if I go below my grandfather cap?
Yeah.
Okay. Are there any other questions? I, in looking at this resolution, am completely comfortable with the rest of it. I'm still uncomfortable with Article 15, Section 2 and 3 of Article 15, and would like to make a motion that we Greg, what's going to be the best way to do it? To approve the resolution minus Section 2 and 3 of Article 15 until we can have some further discussion on it with when the city manager's back in town?
I think that would be fine, Mayor. That would.
Then I would move for approval of Resolution 086584 minus Section 2 and 3 of Article 15, allowing changes in the above articles in the personnel manual.
Second that.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve Resolution 086584 minus Sections 2 and 3 of Article 15, allowing for the changes in the above articles in the personnel manual. Is there any further discussion on that?
So are we going to discuss this at some detail before?
I would like to I would like to have staff bring it back to us at the second January meeting.
January
12th, and that will give us time to visit. So all those in favor of that motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. Thank you, Ms. Fisher. Development business.
Item 7.1, accept the offered easement and right-of-way dedications and authorize the mayor to sign the Great Plains Campus replat.
Mr. Andrew.
Commissioners, this is an application to replat a piece of property that it's actually multiple pieces of property that are located on the north side of East North Street, east of Ohio Street. And this property consists of three separate subdivision plats, and the first of which was approved and recorded in 1917. And this is an area where we've got overlapping tax parcel boundaries and legal descriptions that run into pages, and a difficulty sometimes figuring out what parcel of land goes with what building. And the owner's representative, James Hall, and their surveyor, Bill Delker, agreed to take on a task of piecing together those past plats and surveys and to create and define, I'd like to say once and for all, but hopefully a campus for Great Plains manufacturing facilities and other buildings in this area. We've got a two-page report here, but that doesn't begin to summarize the undertaking that this was for Mr. Hall and his surveyor, but it required a great deal of historical research and working with the landowners in the area and all the utility providers to put this together. And so what we've got is a combining of three separate subdivisions into one. We're working with 12 additional property owners who have property interspersed within this area, and the result will be 20 lots that comprise two blocks and easy to read and understand descriptions of all the property. The other benefits will be this is going to clearly match up with existing ownership and development conditions. It's going to clearly define which parcel of land goes with which facility, and also will put on the drawing, a single drawing, all the locations of public and franchise utility lines. And so this will greatly facilitate everybody's understanding of what is in this area. This replat was reviewed by the Planning Commission on the 2nd of December. And they voted to approve it, subject to some technical corrections and additions being made. We have met and worked closely with all the franchise and public utility providers and have all those easements depicted on the plat drawing and all technical corrections made. And we've been lining up the multiple owners today to come in and sign the plat. So we believe this is in order for the Commission's consideration, and if you are in concurrence with the action of the Planning Commission, a motion should be made to accept the offered easement and right-of-way dedications and authorize the mayor to sign the campus replat. I'd be happy to stand for any questions that you might have, and James Hall, representative of the owner, is here also.
Questions of staff.
So all this is under the ownership of Great Plains? Or are there
no, we have 12 other owners here that are as diverse as homeowners and the Salina Kennel Club and Wallace Landscaping. And
but they've all had plenty of opportunity to comment
yes,
on this.
Yes, they are. They've been in the loop from the beginning, and I said we have been in the process today of obtaining all their signatures as part of that, and that of course was part of the complication. It's much easier if you just have one owner, but we're dealing with 12 diverse owners, but they've all been supportive and cooperative and made this come together.
Other questions of staff? Thank you, Dean. Any public comment?
James Hall, 1525 East North Street. This has been a giant housekeeping task that we've needed to done for a long time, and really appreciate all the help we got from Dean and from the other property owners in the area. Everybody was very appreciative of the fact that they can now throw their 3.5 pages of legal descriptions away and get a lot 2, block 3, and they're done. Everybody's worked together very well, and it's been a very cooperative project, so please sign it.
We're happy about that, too. Thank you for your efforts. There's no other public comment. I'll bring it back to the commission.
I would move that we accept the offered easements and right-of-way dedications and authorize the mayor to sign the Great Plains campus replat.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to accept the offered easement and right-of-way dedications, authorize the mayor to sign the Great Plains campus replat, which is application PO8-8 and 8A. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 7.2, application number Z08-10, requesting a change in zoning district classification from A-1 to PC-5 for a 27.49 acre tract of land located between South 9th Street and Interstate 135 of the Riffle Addition. Item 7.2A, first reading, ordinance number 0810479.
Mr. Andrew.
This property is what staff refers to as out in the KDOT slip ramp area. And for those of you with long memories, you didn't used to be able to get off at Schilling Road at that interchange. There were ramps that you got off before you got to Schilling Road that went directly over to 9th Street. And those were abandoned in the early 90s when the Schilling Road interchange was rebuilt and reconfigured. KDOT had an intent to sell off or market that property after it was abandoned and declared surplus, but they battled with title issues based on the way they acquired the property that went on for years. So Mr. Riffle was patiently waiting the opportunity to acquire a piece of that so his property that he owned that had I-135 frontage would have 9th Street frontage. And that occurred this year, and the result of that, which it's difficult to see on the screen, but I think you can see in your packet, is that there's two triangular pieces there, and the southern triangle reverted back to Long MacArthur Ford, and the north triangle reverted back to Mr. Riffle, and that gave him frontage on 9th Street, a rectangular parcel. And now that he has that, he is ready to start preparing the site for development. The first step in that is that the property is currently unplatted and zoned agricultural, and Mr. Riffle is seeking a C5 service commercial zoning for the property. To the best of our knowledge, the applicant has no specific uses or development plans for the property at this time, but is trying to get it into position where it can be used and developed for commercial purposes that are consistent with the South 9th Street overlay. And that overlay district purposely had a short list of uses so that other uses that might be large traffic generators could be reviewed on a case-by-case basis. The applicant did ask that hotels, motels, restaurants, farm and ranch supply stores, and garden centers also be included as permitted uses in this district, and that request was recommended for approval by the Planning Commission. The site has 1,300 feet of frontage on 9th Street. The way the preliminary plat is laid out, the access would match up with the existing median openings for avenues A and B across the street. And I think if you've driven by the property, it kind of sits in a bowl relative to 9th Street. And the plan is to import, I believe, close to 80,000 cubic feet of fill to raise that area to allow it to reach the elevation of 9th Street and have positive drainage. The planned C5 zoning would be compatible with what is around it in the surrounding area. The county property to the east is all zoned industrial. In 1999, there was a major utility project that extended both water and sewer down South 9th Street. At the time, this property had an agricultural deferral, and a cost recovery was put on the KDOT portion. So when this property gets platted in 2009, this property will start paying into the water and wastewater fund and start paying an assessment for those lines, which was deferred earlier. This request also went in front of the Planning Commission on December the 2nd, and at the close of the hearing, they recommended approval of the request subject to platting of the property, and again, they approved the applicant's request or recommended approval that farm and ranch supply stores, garden centers, hotels and motels, and restaurants be considered as approved permitted uses. And if that request is approved, then the applicant could market those sites for those purposes. With that, I'd be happy to address any questions you have. Mr. Riffle's representative, Pete Earls, is here if you have questions of him.
Questions of staff? Guess not. Thank you, Mr. Andrew. Any public comment? If not, I'll bring it back to the commission.
Revenue, I move that we adopt ordinance number 0810479.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve ordinance 0810479 on first reading, which is the approval of application 0810 for Riffle Moving Services to change zoning classification from agricultural to PC5. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 7.3, resolution number 08-6582, amending section 3 of resolution number 04-6028 to extend the Neighborhood Revitalization Plan tax rebate program until March 31st, 2009.
Mr. Hobby.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mayor and commissioners, the city staff is working with local developers as well as representatives from the Chamber of Commerce who happen to be here today, as well as other people in our community to look at our Neighborhood Revitalization Plan. If we remember earlier this year, we brought to you a plan and looked at doing an extension, remodel, or change on that plan, and that's what we've decided that we'd like to work on. City staff has been working on adding to this plan area Census Tracts 3 and Census Tracts 4, and is in the process of reviewing those census tracts for the valuation of properties within that area, as well as looking at the need for the properties for revitalization in that specific area. The city staff has not completed that process yet, and we ask that you will extend the existing plan for 3 more months till March the 31st, 2009, to allow city staff to finalize the mapping, finalize the assessment of the area, and extend this program through March 31st, where we can bring back a new program to you and have you adopt a new program in the year 2009. You have before you the resolution number 086582, which actually just extends the existing program for a period of 3 months through the end of March 31st of 2009, while city staff finalizes the new program for you to look at. I'd be glad to stand for any questions.
Questions of staff? Thank you, Mr. Hobby. Any public comment? Bring it back to the commission.
Mayor, I move that we approve resolution 08-6582, which extends the existing Neighborhood Revitalization Plan tax rebate program until March 31st of 2009.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to approve resolution 086582, extending the current Neighborhood Revitalization Plan until March 31, 2009. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 7.4, resolution number 08-6585, authorizing the mayor to execute storm drainage covenants for the Shops at Meadow Point development.
Mr. Schreck.
Thank you, Mayor. This is the item that was added to the agenda this afternoon. So with your indulgence, I'll go into a little bit greater detail than I might typically do if you've had it to look at in advance. This issue relates to the Shops at Meadow Point, which are the proposed commercial development in the northeast quadrant of Ohio and Cloud Street, as kind of a point of reference, and it relates to amending the terms related to stormwater improvements from the 1999 agreement that's currently in place to be more reflective of the current circumstances. So having said that, in 99, a three-party agreement regarding installation of stormwater improvements was executed between the City of Salina, the owners of the 10 acres in question, which at the time was the Virgil and Dorothy Lundberg Trust Number 1, and the Emmanuel Four Square Church. The city's interest in that agreement related to the area in question being designated as a critical drainage area subject to additional review and design standards. So our role in that agreement pertained to the required storm drainage improvements. At the time the agreement was executed, there was an existing detention basin that detained water on the property of the Emmanuel Four Square Church and a pump system that discharged stormwater from that basin at a controlled rate to the northeast through the adjoining residential subdivisions, and that continues to be the case today. The agreement provided for expansion of the detention basin to accommodate the development of the 10-acre site, installation of a pump and discharge line, which would redirect that discharge to the Ohio Street storm sewer system, which then would mitigate the impacts of stormwater discharge in the adjoining properties, and allocation of ongoing maintenance responsibilities for the improvement amongst the church and the owners of the 10-acre site. The provisions at that time assumed full development of the 10 acres without providing for any type of phased development, and now what's before you is to try to take into account a phased development approach. It also included a specific prohibition against issuing any building permits until such time as the required improvements were installed, which is part of the issue today in terms of our ability to issue building permits. Since the time that the original agreement was drafted and executed, the detention basin has been expanded in conjunction with grading work that was done by Emmanuel Four Square Church. So the detention capacity of that basin has increased, and the property has changed hands and is now owned by Insight Medical Partners, and they have proposed a phased development as shown in Exhibit A and as John has on the screen this afternoon. Upon reviewing the existing conditions, staff has concluded that the expanded detention basin, in combination with the proposed phasing, with the first phase being shown in the dark black dotted line on the screen, taking those two things into account, we've concluded that the city's storm drainage requirements could be met by allowing phase one to proceed and accounting for that expanded detention basin, and that to really take into account the critical drainage issues, the improvements would be needed prior to completion of phase two. As a result then, city staff has met with the representatives of the developer as well as representatives of the Emmanuel Four Square Church and discussed the revision of the existing agreement to allow that phase construction, and consensus has generally been reached among the parties. The attached resolution and storm drainage covenants were drafted to account for the changed circumstances and formalize the consensus that was reached among the parties. I should tell you that this proposed approach and the storm drainage covenants have all been discussed very recently. It's somewhat time sensitive for the developer, so it's all progressed basically the end of last week and today. The draft language would be presented to both the developer and Emmanuel Four Square Church for their consideration in speaking with the church through their California, but seemed optimistic that they could do that in an expedited manner and that they would rely on the input from the local church representatives. So the attached resolution has been drafted to authorize the mayor to sign the storm drainage covenants in substantially the form that they've been presented, with minor modifications as approved by the city manager or his designee. If necessary, I'd be happy, along with staff's assistance, to walk you through the provisions of the storm drainage covenants. But it tries to take into account the changes in circumstances since 1999, provide for phased development, and leave all the responsibility for installation as well as ongoing maintenance as was originally proposed in 1999. As part of the fiscal note in the blue sheet, you might note that there were provisions in the 99 agreement that are carried forward in these terms related to funding of this proposed storm drainage improvements. And what those provisions were that the cost of design and construction of the discharge line would be paid for at city at large through a special assessment financing mechanism. And that is not a unique provision to what we're presenting to you today. That's just picking up what was previously agreed to in 1999. The remaining costs were previously agreed to be special assessed financed at the developer's expense. And there will be some expenses involved with installation of pumps to pump it to Ohio Street. And lastly, maintenance of the pump, the existing pump, as well as the proposed new pump and discharge line, will be the responsibility of Insight in this case, or the developer. Maintenance of the detention basin would remain, is currently and would remain the responsibility of the church. So those are all circumstances that really haven't changed from the 99 agreement to what's before you today. In terms of possible options for the City Commission, in summary, you could deny the proposed resolution and covenants, which would result in the existing terms still being in place. It would mean that a building permit couldn't be issued until the required improvements were installed. You could provide us some direction as to specific concerns and amend the language of the agreement. You could also provide staff with direction to bring back to you any type of revised language. And then lastly, you could approve the resolution as proposed, which would result in the mayor's authorization to sign the covenants and allow for minor modifications subject to the city manager's review and approval. With that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Questions of staff. If I've read this right, the drainage plan that's in place right now, the original one, 1999, holds true through phase one, but at the beginning of phase two is when the pumps and the line to Ohio Street need to be constructed.
The original provisions in 1999 didn't break the project into phases.
I understand.
So that would be installed before a building permit's issued. The
Correct.
Proposed changes break Right. it into phases. Existing detention basin, existing discharge continues with the expansion of the detention size.
Correct.
Would continue and allow phase one to be under construction. A certificate of occupancy couldn't be issued for phase two or three until the required improvements discharging to Ohio Street were installed and accepted by the city.
Phase one construction could begin and occupancy could occur with the drainage as it is now.
Correct.
And anything phase two and beyond, the pumps and the pipe have to be installed.
Correct.
Gotcha. Any other questions of staff? In public comment? Bring it back to the commission.
Mayor, I'd move the resolution 086585 authorizing the mayor to sign storm drainage covenants in substantially form presented, allowing minor modifications subject to the review and city of the city manager for this subdivision be approved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve resolution 086585 authorizing the mayor to execute a storm drainage covenants on behalf of the city of Salina. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0. Administration.
Item 8.1, second reading, ordinance number 08-10478, annexing city-owned property located on the east side of South Ohio Street between Magnolia and Schilling Roads.
This ordinance was passed on first reading December 15th, and since then no comments have been received. Are there any public comments? Bring it back to the commission.
Mayor, I move we adopt ordinance number 08-10478 on second reading.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt ordinance 08-10478 on second reading. All those in favor signify by saying aye. I'm sorry, would the clerk please call the roll?
Commissioner Jilka?
Aye.
Commissioner Larson?
Aye.
Commissioner Peck?
Aye.
Commissioner Perney?
Aye.
Mayor Vanier?
Aye. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 8.2, authorized purchase of an ambulance.
And who gets this one?
Like Marvin.
Fire department.
EMT.
Mayor, commissioners. This is a request for the City Commission to approve the purchase of one ALS medic unit. On December 9th, 2008, bids were opened for a medium-duty chassis ALS unit. The specifications were for a 2009 medium-duty chassis ALS unit to replace an existing 1999 Ford Type 3 ambulance. The five bids were received were as listed. TaylorMade Ambulance, their unit is called TaylorMade, had a base bid of $180,146. They had a trade-in allowance for the 99 Ford of $6,000, And then we also excluded options at a cost of $18,982, and the total bid at that point in time was $155,164. Murphy's Fire and Rescue bid a McCoy Miller, which come in as a base bid of $189,950. They gave us $12,950 for the trade-in, and then we excluded $19,410 on the options, and it came in at $157,590. Midwest Vehicle Professionals, MVP, bid a road rescue, which its base bid was $187,450, with a $6,000 trade-in and $18,262 of options taken away. It came in at a base total bid of $163,188. Conrad Fire Equipment, which is a med tech, come in at his base bid of $191,109, minus $5,000 for a trade-in and minus $16,883 on options, which had a total bid then of $169,226. Emergency Services, which is an Osage ambulance, come in at $197,875 with $5,000 trade-in and $17,962 less options, came in at a total bid of $174,913. The bids were thoroughly evaluated by the members of the Department's EMS Ambulance and Purchasing Committee. TaylorMade Ambulance is a full-line emergency vehicle manufacturer and a remount facility. They have no custom medikits in the state of Kansas, and those references I did have, I made contact, were for remount units only. Murphy's Fire and Rescue does not meet the 41.1 specification, which states in part, the entire body will be a welded and seamless one-piece body. The entire perimeter and around all openings of the body shall be fully welded and grooved smooth, thus eliminating any joints or seams. The use of tongue and groove methods of construction that requires the use of seam sealer is not acceptable. This is to prevent the cracking of paint and those areas resulting in buildup of road dirt, grime, and eventually development of corrosion along the tongue and groove seams. Murphy's Fire and Rescue also did not meet specifications for the air ride system, ducting of heat and cold to run length of the ceiling in the patient compartment, and they're unable to provide the front exterior compartment we request due to construction of the curbside door. Murphy's Fire and Rescue also took an exception to the penalty for delay in delivery. The increased cost of the medic units from previous years is because we have switched from an E450 Type 3 ambulance Ford truck chassis to a medium-duty Chevy C4500 chassis. There were reasons to switch chassis due to problems associated with the Ford 6.2 diesel engines. There was numerous errors or numerous problems with those engines. Upon comparing the bids and all the associated exceptions, clarifications, and omissions, the Salina Fire Department staff recommends purchasing the Road Rescue ALS unit from Midwest Vehicle Productions, MVP, which is not the lowest bid, but does meet or exceed all requested specifications. The base bid from MVP, again, was $187,450 with trade-in of $6,000, and then additional cost savings can be obtained by removing five equipment options from the bid, which accounted for $18,262, which then brings the final cost to $163,188. We did have $165,000 that was budgeted into the CIP account with the anticipation of this purchase. Conformance with the strategic plan, the city will provide the highest quality of service consistent with governing body direction, available resources, and staff commitment to quality. The fire administration recommends consideration of the following options. Number one, approve the purchase of the 2009 Chevy C4500 Road Rescue Medic Unit from MVP. And number two, approve an alternative and provide direction to the fire department. Fire administration staff recommends option number one.
Questions of staff?
Well, he explained it quite a bit of length about why you didn't like the second bid, Murphy's, but I didn't understand what was really wrong with TaylorMade.
TaylorMade has no units in the state of Kansas that we can find.
Well, what does that mean?
Well,
I mean, do they have them in existence anywhere?
They do have them in existence in anywhere, but they're mainly down south, and the majority of them are remount units, which means that they take an existing box and put on a new chassis. That when I contacted them and talked with them, they of course said, yeah, we can do anything you want. It's a custom box. Well, I couldn't find anybody that they had developed custom boxes for. Everybody that I called had remount boxes.
So you're saying they've never actually built one like that?
No, I don't know. I just the references that I had didn't have any brand new boxes. They were all remounts.
Hmm.
So. How long have you had the one that you're trading in?
It's a 1999.
Okay.
We're right now on about a 7 to 8 year rotation on medic units. Going out, we have seven units.
Seven.
Mm-hmm. Nice golf carts faster than that. There are some advantages to the road rescue is that it is all aluminum body. It is one piece body. There is no wood construction in this medic unit as there are in other medic units. And wood has a tendency to rot over time, even though it's not supposed to. It has a tendency to have certain areas within that box that will rot out that they have to either go back in and fix or replace. This is fully aluminum. Even the floor, all the mounts to the floor and everything else, all the cabinets are all aluminum made.
Other questions of staff? Thank you. Any public comment? Bring it back to the commission.
Mayor, I'd move we approve the purchase of a 2009 Chevy C4500 Road Rescue Medic Unit from MVP.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to authorize a purchase of an ambulance from MVP in the amount of $163,188. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 8.3, authorize the purchase of full court software for the municipal court.
Jack.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. Our current municipal court software is in need of replacement. Our municipal court personnel have wanted to move to a system called full court for several years, but the cost of the software has never made it through the budget approval process. This year, the city prosecutor's office had a system called full case installed. This is a case management system that was developed by Justice Systems, the same vendor that also developed Full Court. The city's prosecutor's office has been very pleased with how Full Case works and how it has improved their productivity. Full Case dovetails with Full Court, and we feel it's time to move our municipal court to software specifically designed for courts, which also works well with the city prosecutor's system. The municipal court judge and all the municipal court staff have strongly urged my department to assist them with switching to software that will make them more productive. This year, there are funds available in the 2008 computer technology sub-CIP budget to purchase the full court software. The hardware we previously purchased this year to support the full case system was sized large enough to handle the addition of this software, so we should not need any more hardware. 10 concurrent licenses, installation, setup, 1 week on-site training, e-payment services, imaging, and annual maintenance come to a cost of $52,070. This purchase was not specifically budgeted for in 2008, but right now my budget has $115,000 left in it, and I would use part of that for this $52,000. Staff recommends that the City Commission authorize the Municipal Court to enter into a contract with Justice Systems for 10 concurrent user system cost of $52,070. Any tough questions, I will defer to Jane Eilers and Brenda Stoss here. The easy ones I'll take myself, so I would be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Questions of staff. Are there any ongoing yearly maintenance fees?
Yeah, the maintenance agreement with this would be about $7,000 a year.
Okay.
That's included in here, but it would be in addition to next year I would do it again, but not the whole price. But this year is $52,000, next year would be about $7,000.
Okay. And that's been budgeted into the municipal court budget? Is that, or that's your budget? Okay.
How long have they been running on this old system?
Mid-90s.
Oh, so it's probably time.
Well, it's a new world system for public safety, which is a great public safety system, but it wasn't a municipal court system. It was written as an add-on to get them by, but it is not a very good municipal court system.
Other questions of staff? Any public comment? I'll bring it back to the commission.
Mayor, I'd Move that we approve the purchase of full court software for the City of Salina Municipal Court.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to purchase full court software for the Municipal Court from Justice Systems in the amount of $52,070. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 8.4, authorize the purchase of an email spam filter and email archiving solution.
Mr. Balfes.
Thank you again, Mayor and Commissioners. Currently have a couple problems in my department, probably more than that, but a couple I'll admit to you today. One of them, our spam filtering system is not keeping up with all the new spammer ideas that are going on. And second of all, we don't have any capability to archive our email. By archiving, I mean the ability to store any email that comes into our system or out of our system. These archived emails need to be set so they cannot be altered or deleted, and then we need to be able to search them any way we can, especially for legal reasons. And I don't have the capability to do that now. On our worst spam day, we've gotten over 120,000 spams. And unfortunately, I'm the spam guy in our department, and it's starting to kill me, basically. We started looking at a new solution early this year. Mike Jenkins, our network administrator, was tasked with that, and he's looked at a lot of different solutions, but I figured we'd come up with a different spam solution in our email archiving system. He has found one that does both. Currently, we're spending up to 2 hours a day managing spams, and our current system is in-house. We looked at systems that required all hardware and software to be in-house. We also looked at systems that involved everything to be outsourced. In-house systems involve buying hardware and continually increasing disk space. And as we archive more and more emails, that grows and grows. Long-term operating projections indicate that an outsourced solution would be more cost-effective and certainly would allow us to minimize CT staff time used to manage the system. So we solicited proposals from people that did outsourcing. We looked at Google Postini, MX Logic, and AT&T. Google Postini was clearly cheaper than everybody else, so we asked them to let us demo their system. So it has been brought in, and we've been using it for over a month with just a few select people, and it's worked quite well. We did budget $30,000 for this project in 2008, and this would be a cost of $16,650, but next year it would be a cost of $15,750, so it's ongoing cost. The first year is a little higher because of setup costs. Staff recommends that the City Commission authorize the Computer Technology Department to enter into a contract with Google Postini for email spam filtering and email archiving at a first-year cost of $16,650, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Questions?
Does this go on forever at $15,000 a year or so?
Yes, it does.
So do we have we had an expense like that in the past? Or is this
we haven't ever archived our email. We could probably spend $3,000 to $4,000 on a current email spam system. Mm-hmm. This would do spam and emails. And we really need to get to some kind of archiving system that's kind of required by law.
How safe is outsourcing this?
Well, 3 years ago, I would have probably not even recommended that to you, but Google Postini does all of YouTube's applications. They have all the disk space required by that. They supposedly sign up a couple thousand customers a day. Johnson County, the state of Kansas, city of Wichita, city of Hutchinson, USD 420, and Osage City all use them as a spam filter. And so today, I would say it's very safe. And it's really nice that they manage everything for you. And they don't care how many emails you have. They just take care of all the disk spaces and let you search their stuff upon request.
So you said you've been using it for about 30 days. How has that reduced your spam then?
Not much, because my other 350 users are still killing me. But it's reduced spam like crazy for those five people that are on it.
Okay.
But I can't put everybody on it because I haven't paid for it.
Okay.
I tend to be picky about that.
Yeah, that's my pet
peeve. Other questions of staff? Thank you. Any public comment? Bring it back to the commission.
Mayor, I'd move we approve the purchase of an email spam filter and email archiving solution from Google Postini.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to authorize the purchase of an email spam filter and email archiving solution from Google Postini in the amount of $16,650. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 5-0.
Mayor Vanir, I move to recess into executive session for 20 minutes to discuss with legal counsel matters subject to the attorney-client privilege for the reason that public discussion of those matters would waive the privilege and adversely affect the city's interest in the matters, and reconvene in this room at 5:20 p.m.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adjourn into executive session for 20 minutes. Do you anticipate any action?
No, we do not.
All right. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. We're in executive session. I'd like to wish everyone a very Merry Christmas. Be safe.